英語だけを話したら日本語は本当に難しい言葉です。英語と日本語を比べたら類似はあまりないですね。文法とか単語とかひらがなとかたかなと漢字とかたくさん違いがありますよ。だからどうやってアンディさんは2年以内に日本語をわかるようになりましたか？この動画はアンディさんの日本語の勉強仕方を説明します。First of all, leave a big ol' like and subscribe for that Japanese intro. I started studying Japanese in 2016 at the beginning of my second year in university. I'm taking Japanese 1A and I decide I like the language. So right then, right there, I decided to commit to a Japanese minor in addition to my marketing major and music minor. For my first year of study, I had approximately 1 hour long classes 4 days a week. And that was the extent of what I was really doing to study.Those classes and the homework and curriculum. It wasn't until my second year when I planned to study abroad in the following summer where things really took off. Here's how. And to be clear, there are no gimmicks in this video. Language learning takes a lot of time and effort, especially when it comes to Japanese. But these strategies worked amazingly for me and generally kept me at the top of my Japanese classes through my university career. Let's get started. Number one.Urgency. It was the beginning of my second year learning Japanese. I planned to study abroad the following summer for a summer course, and I'd be living with a Japanese host family. Of course, I didn't expect to be like fluent by then, but I did have a goal. Even if I stumble, even if I make a ton of mistakes, I want to be able to have conversations. In a very short time frame, that goal is doable in almost every language. And even though Japanese is tougher than most languages an English speaker can learn,It's still doable. On top of that, when failure isn't an option, your timeline to succeed is limited, but that timeline is realistic enough that you can do it. That's a lot of motivation and adds a ton of urgency, which I was held accountable for by number two, taking classes. Lots of language learning people on YouTube tend to be totally against traditional classes for language learning. And to an extent, I agree, but to an equal and opposite extent, I also disagree. Here's my perspective. Many people, as they take language courses, view them as a one-way ticket to fluency without having to do anything outside the curriculum. And if that's your perspective, you're never gonna be fluent. You're wrong and you'll be disappointed. However, if you view language courses as a detailed, structured resource to build your own curriculum and studies around, they are amazing. When learning any skill, it's really hard to know where to start, what's relevant, and what you should be working on next at your current skill level. Classes often curate that experience and help teach you what you know when you need to know it, in a reasonable pace. And while it may be true that all the information you need to learn a skill or language or anything is available for free on the internet, it's almost impossible to get all the information, put it all together, and know where to find it and how to use it. On the internet, you'll find the issue of too much information. On top of that, there's the risk of incorrect information as well as other issues. Structured classes overcome this issue.You don't need to know where to look or where to start because it's presented to you. Of course, some classes might have irrelevant vocabulary when it comes to strictly being able to communicate freely, but I would much rather have a curated experience than have to figure these things out myself. You also get to make a whole lot of similar-minded friends to help motivate you and to study with. Some of the friends I made in Japanese class are still among some of the closest friends I have today. Structured classes gave me a solid foundation to use alongside number three, immersion. If you want to be able to communicate in a language, you have to communicate in that language. Lots of people think, oh, I'll focus on reading and writing, and then eventually, when I have a lot of information, I'll be able to use it and speak. Nope! You need to communicate to be able to communicate. You'll make mistakes, but your confidence will grow and you will get better. In fact, unless those mistakes impact your ability to be understood,Just blow through them in a typical conversation, unless you want the other person to correct you. You'll surprise yourself with how much more you're able to communicate when you stop overthinking your mistakes as you go. Of course, you'll want to review your mistakes, but don't worry about it in a conversation. So, story time. In my second year of studying Japanese, I joined my university's Japanese Student Society. It was basically a club for Japanese culture, relevant events, and a place for international students from Japan. The club had a ton of immersion opportunities, so because of that, I got really involved, ended up an officer in my second semester in the club, and kind of ended up as the president in my last year in the club, but that's besides the point. The club held well-designed, very creative language exchange events. They were basically guided bilingual activities between American students improving their Japanese and Japanese international students improving their English. I made a point to attend every single one of these events, and they were the number one biggest factor in me improving my confidence to be able to communicate in Japanese. By my second semester in the Japanese Student Society, which is about a year and a half into my Japanese studies, also just a few months before leaving to live abroad for the summer, I was nowhere near fluent, but I was confident enough to communicate. And it was all thanks to those immersion opportunities. I really, really highly recommend meeting like-minded people studying your language of choice and attending events that provide authentic immersion opportunities. Immersion and authentic communication will supercharge your ability to communicate in a language. Immersion through the Japanese club was by far the number one factor in improving my conversational confidence. But that confidence was not through immersion alone. It was also through number four, repetition. Between my class curriculum and my immersion opportunities, I realized that if I wanted to be fluent with my limited vocabulary, I had to be able to recall it quickly. The less you need to think about the words that you use, the more freely you can communicate. I got to this point with a lot of repetition. That was mainly through digital flashcards on the app called Memrise. I'd mainly use it to study the vocabulary for my classes, but I definitely used it for a lot more than just that. If immersion and language exchange gave me the confidence to communicate, repetition and drilling my vocabulary allowed me to communicate with confidence. The less time you take to recall a word, the more practice and improvement you get out of any given conversation. Since you get more conversing per minute when you're taking fewer pauses, the less time it takes to think of a word, the more words you can exchange. Simple as that. And it really only takes an additional 5 or 10 minutes of studying each day on vocabulary, on top of whatever other studying you're doing. Use Memrise, Anki, physical flashcards, or any other tool that helps you drill your vocabulary and communicate with confidence. Get those reps in. I don't have a good transition for this one, but let's move on to the next point. Number five, redefining the word fluent. For many people, the word fluent means you're basically at a native speaker level of the language. It is the end point. You cannot get better than fluent at a language. It's black and white. You're either fluent or you're not. I strongly disagree with that sentiment. Fluency, like many things, is a non-concrete spectrum. There are varying levels of fluency, like basic, survival, conversational, advanced, native level. You get the idea. Believing that you're not fluent until you're perfect at a language and that it's the very end of the road of your studies is a total confidence killer. If you don't think you have any fluency, you're probably not going to even try to communicate in the language, because you may never feel that your skill in the language is adequate enough to do so. On top of varying levels of fluency, you can also be fluent in certain ranges of vocabulary. For example, I'm extremely fluent when it comes to ordering food, but if you ask me to discuss, like, advanced scientific stuff or, like, the real nitty-gritty of politics, I can talk basic Japanese politics, but, like, the nitty-gritty of politics, I'm not fluent. These two frames of thinking about fluency make it so that it's a bunch of bite-sized chunks rather than the end of the road. If it's the end of the road, most people never achieve that level. But if it's bite-sized chunks, you can get fluent in a certain set of vocabulary in a couple days, and that majorly helps with your confidence to communicate. I started thinking about fluency this way the same time I was doing the language exchange program. I went from saying, I am not fluent at Japanese, to saying, I am fluent in basic conversation. That mindset totally flipped a switch in my head. I noticed the small mistakes, but I didn't sweat them. I'd only stop the conversation if the other person could not understand me. And I still make a ton of mistakes in Japanese, but for the most part, I'm totally understood when I speak. Think of this kind of fluency as like getting experience in RuneScape. Yeah, RuneScape. You don't need to kill a monster to get experience points from it. You get experience for doing damage. With fluency, you don't need to defeat the entire language to become fluent. You get pieces of fluency as you go. And that brings us to number 6, immersion. Again.
Wait, wasn't immersion number 3?
Yes, and it's such an important point that I'm giving it 2 slots. This immersion, however, is immersion in the country. After following steps 1 through 5 only in the United States, this video is titled How I Got Fluent in Japanese in 2 Years. And year 3 does not start until my 4th year of university or my 3rd year of learning Japanese. So, we have this whole summer in Japan to include here. After following steps 1 through 5, I actually was confident enough to communicate relatively freely in Japan during my summer class. But that confidence was only the beginning. Of course, I couldn't carry a long conversation, I couldn't go into intense detail, but by the end of the summer, I was a different man. I was about to spend 2 months living in Japan, half of which would be living with a Japanese host family. Let me tell you, when you have no choice but to speak Japanese for 3 to 5 hours a day or more, you improve really, really quickly. And you improve even faster if you have a solid foundation like I developed over the first year and 9 months. If my classes, my language exchange, my repetition, all that were enough to start the engine, living in Japan is what supercharged it. I really felt like I got 2 years worth of study in the span of 2 months. And after those 2 months in Japan, the time from starting to learn the language up until then had finally hit 2 years. And when I got back to my first day of Japanese class the following semester, I literally was able to speak twice as fast. My friends were like, Andy, what happened? How did you get so fast at speaking Japanese? And it's because I spoke Japanese in Japan for 2 months. It was really difficult. I was so happy to hear the English language when I got home. But I improved so much, and it was one of the best experiences of my life. With all these points in mind, here are some practical steps you can take to start improving your Japanese and apply these points right now. I'll have a lot more to say if you're a university student rather than if you're someone learning Japanese in your spare time post-university. If you're a university student studying Japanese, here are some things I recommend. Set a goal and get some urgency. Practice without a purpose is almost always slower than training with a goal. Whether that goal is studying abroad in Japan, a long trip to Japan, or just simple checkpoints for progress you set along the way, a goal will speed you up dramatically. Next, join relevant student organizations. Even if they don't have a language exchange program like I did, chances are you will meet people who you can study with, who will help motivate you to study, or native speakers to practice with. The Japanese Student Society at my university ended up being one of the main hubs of my social life in college, and I'm still really good friends with both the students from my university and the international students who went there. Next, get flashcards, digital or otherwise. I personally use Memrise, and I've been in that ecosystem for like 5+ years now, oh my god. But a lot of people use Anki. Whatever you choose to use, find a deck of vocab or build a deck of vocab, and spend at least 5 minutes a day studying. Your fluency will thank you. Last, the most important thing you can do to improve your language ability is to study abroad or spend extended time abroad. I personally wish I could have done more than just a summer. In total, I have spent 5 months in Japan across 3 trips. One was study abroad, one was an internship, and another was study abroad. But a semester, a year, or even your entire college education in a foreign country will dramatically improve your ability to learn that language, even if your college courses are in English. The camera overheated, and I had to let it sit for a while, so where were we? Anyways, if studying abroad is affordable and will not slow down your graduation, it is among the best things you can do for language learning. Look into your university's resources for study abroad opportunities, and look also for financial aid, because most universities offer a lot of financial aid for studying abroad. On top of that, regardless of what country you go to, almost every study abroad opportunity presented by your university is taught in English. So you get to have an education in a language you understand while getting all the immersion of living in a different country. It's amazing. So you won't need to be fluent or even confident upon arrival. Studying abroad might not be the most realistic thing right now or even like within the next semester because of the pandemic. There's a cat right here. But I highly recommend it if you can. Those were my best tips for current university students. Here are some tips for people who are already done with college and are self-studying now. First, look into textbooks or other curated curriculums. With a language as tough as Japanese, it's really important to know where to start. Most universities use the Genki textbooks, and I think they have a really, really great baseline of essential Japanese knowledge. There's very little unnecessary or unhelpful stuff in here. Next, find Japanese study groups, forums, or stuff like that. Having people to study with really helps. And then for immersion, use sites like iTalki to book one-on-one appointments with a native speaker. iTalki tutors vary from casual conversation practice all the way through highly organized and rigorous curriculums. I've been doing iTalki lessons with a tutor every week now for a few months, and it has helped me so much get my Japanese back after not using it since graduation. Last, set a deadline. While international travel may not be very realistic at this moment in time, a Japan trip a year or two from now might be the perfect thing to get your butt in gear to start studying. Get that urgency! So let's wrap this up. My Japanese is not perfect. In fact, it's even worse than it was a year ago when I was just graduating from college. I've only recently been regaining my ability to communicate through weekly lessons with an iTalki tutor, and she's awesome. And that's also why I can personally recommend iTalki. If you're going to get one point out of this video, if you want to be fluent in a language that requires you to be able to communicate, and you have to communicate to be able to communicate. But really the point is, Japanese is a difficult language. It takes a lot of time and effort to even get to basic conversational fluency. However, despite the difficulty of the Japanese language, if you get some urgency to motivate you, find a curriculum to guide you, take advantage of immersion opportunities, drill your vocabulary with tons of repetition, and view fluency as a process rather than a destination, you absolutely will speed up your ability to learn and communicate. And if you like, comment, and subscribe, you might learn even faster. Anyways, thanks for watching. Language learning is tough, but with hard work, the right resources, and the right mindset, you might really surprise yourself with what you can do. Thanks again, and see you next time.